me again. What I want to do now is really to build on what I presented on this morning, and I'm really not going to add many more themes. It's pretty much about giving some examples and unpicking a bit more what we've already heard about this morning in our group discussions as well.
Bianca, so, you need to speak up.
So it's not working.
No, you just want to speak up.
It could be a bit louder.
Really?
Yes, that's how we hear you.
Okay. I shall try. So, what we've already heard is that costs really is one of the key factor that really everything else is related to. Because, yes, if you are small, medium-sized firm, there's not much money in the kitty to provide any additional support that you don't need to support, and even to support to provide the support that you're supposed to. So, we've already heard this morning about the need to shift perceptions of improved working conditions from business costs to business investments. And we know that there are quite a few studies on large firms that will tell you, yes, there is a business case that can be made. Is there a better microphone, Elsie? Because I've
No, we can hear you. No, can hear
yeah, but I have to shout. And I don't want to have to shout for half an hour.
The one at the rostrum was much better.
Just pull it up. I think you can take it out of
there. You can stay there.
I don't like to stay.
I need to move around.
But it won't go.
I don't like to be imprisoned.
It won't go around too much.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you hear me better? No. See, that's much better. Right. And I don't need to shout.
Don't shout.
Okay. I stopped shouting. So where was I? Right, okay. The cost, the business cost, business investments, business case that we've heard about, you know, increasing staff motivation, retention, yes, corporate social responsibility, it's the image of so there are all these points that have been made. But there's this question of whether, effective maternity protection can have positive business outcomes for firms of all sizes. So we've already raised this issue. And that there are challenges that are very specific to the small and medium-sized enterprises and also the informal economy. And I'm going to unpick this a little bit more now. So first of all, the challenges that are specific to small and medium-sized enterprises. So they're very well known, sort of the key characteristic, that they are very resource constrained, that they've got high failure turnover rates. You can read those in your own time. Another key factor is also the attitude of the owner-manager. So if they are not very maternity protection friendly, then this is probably going to trigger down into the whole workplace culture. Small, medium-sized enterprises, or that means their owner-managers very often, also tend to be resistant to government intervention and regulation, simply because it's often just assumed that this will involve costs. Once again, something they don't like very much. And this is why they're preferring more informal approaches to labor management. And this can be bad in some cases, but it can also be positive in others. Small, medium-sized enterprises, the small and the micro firms, are also much more than their larger counterparts, shaped by their local context. And also the societal local norms, values, cultures, the region where they are embedded, or the context where they are embedded. So it's very often, so there's no unified definition of SMEs, simply because another key characteristic is that they're just simply so heterogeneous. There's this huge diversity amongst them. So we also have the sociocultural constraints that were already mentioned earlier. So this is a lot about cultural norms, traditions, expectations with respect to gender roles. So it's about views on women's and men's roles as workers, as well as parents, that influence, the nature effectiveness of maternity protection policies and also the practices. And we actually, in our review, came across this interesting example. It was a study looking at SMEs in Spain and five Latin American countries. And what we saw there was that in the Latin American countries, there was more support of family-friendly practices, but not as you would expect for equality purposes, but more to support women in their traditional roles as carers. So, although those women had the support they maybe needed or wanted, it did not actually challenge the gendered issues of career. So that's another sort of aspect, you know, that you wouldn't necessarily otherwise, you know, come across. But I thought that was a very interesting example. We already spoke about embodiment this morning. So this is a lot about, as we said, the male ideal worker, and then the fact that obviously pregnant and maybe breastfeeding women don't really conform with this perfect male ideal worker norm. And one of the results of this is that women very often, I mean, there are those assumptions that they are, you know, less productive, less reliable, you know, they're unwell all the time, they take time off and they really exploit the situation. So what women very often do in response to, these issues is that they either super perform, which means that they perform beyond expected norms, or they very often also try to hide, well, as we know, early pregnancy, as long as possible, they try to hide their maternal body, or they also hide breastfeeding activities or cease breastfeeding activities either before coming back to work or shortly afterwards because they don't see how they can combine work and breastfeeding. And this leads me to the subject of breastfeeding, because I thought it's very important to also unpick some of, we've spoken about maternity leave quite a lot this morning, and I want to talk a little bit more about breastfeeding. This is something, on the one hand, that I'm personally very interested, passionate about this subject, but at the same time I want to give it as an example of a low or no cost measure of support. So there is a considerable body of research that shows that women's return to work and breastfeeding are difficult to combine, and that stress associated with returning to work and the lack of support can be transferred to the job. So there's this interesting example of this woman. I can just read this out to you because you might not be able to read this at the back. This is actually a Ghanaian study here. There's this woman that says, because I'm always on my feet working, I don't get enough breast milk for my baby, which could be due to work-related stress. Today, I was only able to express 2 ounces for my son, which I know will not be enough for him till I get home. I'm here working, but to be frank with you, I cannot concentrate well at all. I think about my son too much, and I make a lot of mistakes. So this is a very good example of the outcomes of non-support. And I think it's quite surprising as well that this is such a big issue, because when talking about costs, when you go through the literature, it goes to show that breastfeeding support is a measure that really can be very low or no cost, with very positive outcomes. You could just see, you know, the negative outcomes of non-support, and there are quite a few studies that give you the outcomes of support, so reduced maternal absenteeism, improved retention, and so on and so forth. But it's also very important that the support needs to work for the employee. So, for example, giving mothers the opportunity to bring children to work, providing supportive environments for them to breastfeed. And I've got an example to unpick this a bit more. This, once again, is a woman in my Ghana study who's working for a multinational corporation. So it really could have been anywhere in the world, because she's also the one, the example that I gave you earlier this morning, of the person who's getting support beyond legal entitlement. So instead of 3 months of paid maternity leave, she was getting 4. Also, she had the chance to work reduced hours for several months after returning to work at full pay, so it sounded great. Yeah, so she could, instead of working until 5 or 6, she could leave at 3 o'clock. But the issue that she had with this was that her baby was quite far away from the workplace, which means that she couldn't give the baby a feed during working hours, so the support didn't really work for her. She said, well, if you have a 3-month-old baby, it needs, she returned after 4 months, you know, a baby needs a feed between 9 o'clock and 3 o'clock. So she had tried to express breast milk at first, but it didn't work. She got so stressed, she couldn't get enough milk out, so she ended up feeding formula after all. And so the other bit that she was really, you know, annoyed about was, it was really huge premises, and they asked several times to have a creche on site, or just maybe an area allowing for, you know, informal childcare arrangements, but children were not allowed in the office, and that was just the rule, that was it. So I think she's a very good example for, you know, a firm providing really support beyond statutory entitlements, but with still the staff being quite dissatisfied simply because it didn't meet their needs. So obviously when it comes to childcare support, very often, once again, you know, firms very often think this is a very costly form of support. And yes, of course, if you have a proper nursery on site, it is quite costly. But there are also examples that we've seen where it can work for smaller organizations. For example, if there are quite a few smaller organizations within the same geographic area, they can actually set up a nursery together and it can work pretty well. Particularly if you have very similar sort of work patterns and hours of staff working across those different organizations. And yes, there are the informal arrangements where you allow staff to bring children to work maybe in emergencies or even regularly. I mean, we've seen firms where this has been made possible as well. And obviously these can be very low cost support measures as well, and facilitate breastfeeding at the same time. So you provide the key supports that you can provide for women after returning to work, and they don't have to be very expensive. Yeah, social relations shaping maternity protection. I already mentioned that what we saw in the informal economy was that very often they were a lot more flexible in what they women do in terms of support. They very often were able to bring their children to work with them, which, you know, made it possible for them to breastfeed. So that's the possible side of things. But what we could really see, that there was obviously a huge difference in the types of support that were being provided. Was not all just glorious, and the level of support provided was really very much dependent on loyalty and trust, which means that you needed to be a valued member of staff in order to receive the support, and that usually meant you would have been working for that employer maybe for a couple of years and have shown to the employer that you are actually worth the support. But that didn't have to mean that we're talking about highly skilled workers, because very often there is this point that, well, if you're talking about low paid workers, there is no business case simply because there are lots of other people queuing. But even if you are talking to basket weavers, if you're talking to seamstresses, it's still about being very reliable and being a trustworthy member of staff. And so as an example, also just to show you a little bit more what this is about, I spoke to this small interior design business owner, and she gave me the example of two members of staff. So the first one was one, as I said earlier, that she'd known for quite some time. She'd been around, very valued, and she'd actually had two pregnancies, and she'd been given maternity leave pay as far as she could. Her tasks had been changed during pregnancy in order not to put her at risk. And when she came back, she was given a different type of work so that she could actually bring the baby in, breastfeed, and not have to do visits of clients. So it was all basically reorganized around the needs of this woman, simply because she was valued. But then she also mentioned another lady that had only just started to work for her. And she was already pregnant when she started to work for her, but she didn't mention it for obvious reasons. And when the lady found out about the pregnancy, she got rid of the woman straight away. So same employer, but very different approach. But that just goes to show that there are those elements of loyalty and trust. And obviously, for the staff member, they need to be able to trust the employer, you know, to tell them about the pregnancy early on so that there's enough time to manage their pregnancy and their leave. Whereas if you have somebody you, well, can't trust, it's a big problem. So I thought that was also very interesting. I've already mentioned outcomes of non-support, the very frustrated staff member of the large firm that I mentioned earlier. And yes, they were very often complaining about stress lowering their productivity. And one of them said, when my employers are not willing to go the extra mile for me, why should I go another mile for them? And this is obviously something, like looking at the informal small firm employees again, they were willing to really give their lives for their employers because they were very grateful, and they also tended to call their employers mama. It's the extra motivation that they then provided for to their employers. And actually, the bit about the sense of entitlement, that's something where I'd like to ask Sue to tell us a little bit more about that, because I think she's the one who can best do this. Sue, do you want to do this?
Okay.
We actually agreed this. I'm not just coming up with this.
Okay, well, we talked this morning, we heard a lot about legal entitlements or policies, you know, what is available in terms of maternity leave or childcare and so on.
So you have to put the microphone nearer to your mouth.
Is that better?
Okay, so it echoes. So I was saying we talked this morning a little bit about legal entitlements, what people are actually entitled to legally in terms of maternity leave and so on. But there is also, there's legal entitlements, and then there is subjective entitlements or subjective sense of entitlement, which is what people feel they are entitled to, what they feel they deserve, what they feel it's okay to ask for. So you may have an entitlement, legal entitlement, to take however many days to leave, but you may feel that you can't do that because you know it's a small employer and they can't manage if you're away for that long, or because you know that if you take that long, you'll be discriminated against for all sorts of reasons. So sense of entitlement is about the subjective side of entitlements. And a sense of entitlement generally is highly gendered. Who do you think is most has most sense of entitlement?
Men.
For everything.
Men.
Well, there you go, yeah. That's what the research shows. That generally, men tend to have more sense of entitlement than women to many, many things. But in terms of entitlement to maternity support or childcare support, there are gender differences. Men feel more entitled to support at home. Women may feel more entitled to support at work, but not always. So, as we've said, we use the example of maternity leave. There's what you're objectively entitled to and what you feel you can actually take. And this subjective sense of entitlement is based on what you see, what people see as being feasible, how they compare themselves with other people, what is normative. And the reason why men don't feel very entitled to ask for time off for childcare, for example, is obviously because they don't see lots of other men doing it. Women feel more entitled to, in many contexts, to be able to take time off, maternity leave or childcare, and increasingly so, but, there's a big but, they don't feel entitled to do that and still earn as much. So these are generalizations, but this is what the research shows, that women are feeling more entitled to ask for support, but not to also earn as much or progress in their career as much. Sense of entitlement is very much, it's gendered, and it's also very much related to context. So in European research, we found that people who live in, for instance, the Nordic countries have a much higher sense of entitlement to support for maternity protection, for work and family, than in Britain, where women only feel entitled to that if they can see there's a good business case, for example. It's good if I take this because then I'll be able to come back and it's good for the the business. So it's context dependent as well. So basically that's it. The subjective sense of entitlement is what people actually feel entitled to or what they actually are entitled to. It's highly gendered and it's highly context dependent. So it'd be interesting to see what the sense of entitlement is in Malaysia. Okay.
Thank you very much, Sue. And obviously, as a link to the example that I've just given you, those women that I spoke to in the formal economy, in the large businesses, they had a much higher sense of entitlement than the women that I spoke to, who maybe worked in a restaurant, you know, as kitchen staff somewhere in a rural area in the informal economy. But at the same time, those women in the informal economy were quite happy with the support that they were receiving, even if it was just half pay for 3 months or 2 months half pay, simply because they got any support to value, just show appreciation of their efforts. So they were grateful for that and they were paying back. Yes, we also, this morning, we've already heard, you know, about the link to social justice. So why, you know, should it be a business case, social justice case? Why should employers support maternity? Well, I suppose this is something we can explore a lot more over the coming days. The way I see it, sort of, if you take many developed countries with very low birth rates, there is an argument that you can use there. Well, you're talking about the aging population, you want women to have more children, well, maybe you should support this more in the workplace, so you actually have the social outcomes then that way. Then, for example, if you look at many countries where you have very high rates of maternal mortality, there you have the argument saying, right, you could do something very simple as, you know, increasing breastfeeding rates and that way you could save many lives. So you have the social outcomes there. And mostly these, and this is very difficult to prove in many cases, these social outcomes will at some stage translate into the economic outcomes. But obviously, if you have a very small firm and they're just looking at the short-term immediate outcomes, they will not really buy this. And that's a big issue at the moment. The Sustainable Development Goals, I have a slight issue with them personally, simply because, yes, you had the Millennium Development Goals and you had a specific goal for maternal health. It was the least successful of all goals. So not many countries met the targets. I don't even know if any, I'm not sure. But the problem with that is that I think that now in the Sustainable Development Goals, although I think that, you know, this outcome shows that there the need to support maternal health is more pressing than ever, it got hidden now amongst, you know, the maternal health, the gender equality one and the well-being for all aims. And we just had the discussion at the table, well, can you really have a separate goal for maternal health because it's so interrelated with all these other factors? Maybe, but I think just the fact that you have these very negative outcomes shows that you probably should put a particular focus on pushing for this more. You also have the questions around women and empowerment. Obviously, that's an important factor where you're talking about social well-being that can translate into economic development. So I'm not going to talk about this in much detail, but it's obviously also an important factor. And lastly, I want to quickly talk about the role of fathers in this, because we've been hearing several times now that adequate maternity protection is not just about women. And well, it's very different, I suppose, where we are with this across the globe. What we can see in many, like for example, the Scandinavian countries and Germany is that they are actually been introducing something like the use it or lose it policies, where you say, right, like in Germany, they're called the daddy months, 2 daddy months that men can either take and they're paid for, or the leave is lost, so the woman can't take that leave. So many then choose to take this extra leave, obviously. This is how the men get more involved. And I think it's really about breaking these views. We had the discussion at our table just now, where it's always about, well, you know, what are expectations at the workplace? Why don't men take time off more often? For example, if a child is unwell, it's usually this expectation that it is the mother that does that. It's still, you know, in most countries, you know, where fathers are more involved, that they tend to, you know, spend the sort of more enjoyable and more flexible times with children, like taking them to the park, you know, having an ice cream with them, giving them a bath in the evening, yes, when they are home. But for the mothers, it's more, we just said, you know, I can, at school, I can see quite a few daddies that drop off their kids in the morning, but in the afternoons, you will always just see the mummies, because they are the ones who then go part-time so that they've got the chance to collect their children from school. And it's just these little things, but it would change a lot if we had the same amount of fathers, yet, you know, would do the school collections, and that would say, right, actually, I can't come into the office today because my child is unwell. And this is really about, you know, challenging some of the assumptions that we have at the moment. And that's it for now. What I'm going to plan, if you don't have any questions straight away, end of slideshow. I thought there was another slide. This is slightly problematic now because this is not my most recent version, but I can probably just tell you what I would like to do. Because you're supposed to be in two different, well, in the four groups, and I would like to have groups one and two working on the same question, and group two and three and four, sorry. So now I need to remember what it is. I probably need my slide. Let me just get the slide.
And you can talk to each other while I'm doing this. Okay, found it. Right. So we've spoken about statutory provisions. So then it's about, well, what policies do different firms have, and it's also about what's happening in practice. And what I would like you to discuss in groups now in a very informal way is, for the first two groups, it's the relationship between employment characteristics, you know, you find the examples here, and then the workplace culture and worker sense of entitlement that Sue has just spoken about.
Specifically entitlement to support for maternity and work and family.
Mm-hmm. And three and four, looking at also employment characteristics and wider cultural context, and this is about societal attitudes with respect to women's and men's roles as parents and workers. So this is sort of the wider perspective, and this is a little bit more detailed of how this is seeping into the workplace. But I thought that way we can sort of cover all the issues that we've already spoken about. And what I want you to do within the groups is, because I'm very much aware that many of you haven't actually done any research on this themselves, so this is about, well, I suppose either we have personal experience, or we know somebody who has personal experience. We are all working somewhere, and we know of other people's stories, and it's just supposed to be more of an exchange, you know, on the table, to say what, you know, what are our views, what are our experiences around these issues. And what I would then like to see, how much time are we going to give people? 20 minutes?
I don't think we'll be able to do it in the time that we've planned. So can I suggest that we break for tea first, and then come back, because it's 3:45, it's 3:30. So you're not going to get much discussion.
No, you're not going to do it now, after the tea break. So what time did we have the tea break down for?
We can have the tea break now.
Yes, and after the tea break we'll have the discussion. But did we say 20 minutes? Can we still do the 20 minutes?
For each group, we'll do 20 minutes, and then one spokesperson from each group to present the findings. and we will record all the findings and
yeah.
make sure that everybody has them.
Don't let this worry you. Very, you know, very informally.
Just a question. Maybe I'm throwing this more to the Blazin group. When you use the word entitlement, mm-hmm. in English it sounds okay. And then if you go out to the field tomorrow and you want to try and translate this into our language, so I think we should talk about it.
We would, okay.
Now you say how this is
like.
We wouldn't actually use the word entitlement in
no.
interviewing.
Yeah, yeah, but we would conceptually.
Yeah, it's a concept, but it's not what we do this in an interview.
Yeah, so it might be a good idea then to discuss this, you know, at each table. And yes, when doing actual interviews, we would try not to use any jargon whatsoever in order to make everything, you know, all questions very clear. Okay?
Can I suggest that we go for tea and coffee now?
Yeah.
We will come back at maybe 5 to 4. I'm sorry, 5 to 4, and then we have got until, no. If we come back at 10 to 4, then we'll have 55 minutes.
Lovely.
For discussion and presentation of results. Okay?
Okay.
So if you come back at, what did I say, 10 to 4, okay?
I think 5 to will do.
5 to 4, okay?
Well, we have to decide who is going to speak, who is going to present.
Well, we're going to move around, don't we?
Yeah.